Okay, I would like today to talk about, and I didn't get a chance, I did speak for a few moments, but Rob's best friend did his funeral yesterday, which was his cousin, and they have been friends since they were like 7 months old or something. And B.E. Palmer, the priest, is one of my favorites as well. I knew him. He ministered in Gainesville at the Chapel of the Incarnation for many years, and a fantastic guy. And he preached, rightly so, Rob's funeral. But that didn't sit well with me, not because I didn't think he was the right guy to do it, but I wanted to preach my own sermon for Rob. So you know what hit me? Sunday's coming. And so I could preach today what I would have, I don't want to say like to, because I'm not only is B.E. a great preacher and a great Christian, a holy man like Rob, I wouldn't change that, but it was not for me to add to that then, but this morning in Hebrews 11, I want to share the last conversation, the text that Rob and I were talking about, and the last theological conversation we had. The last day I saw him was last Monday. We went there. Pastor Donna Day, she's a Pentecostal pastor and a person who's seen many miracles. And if you're going to go pray for someone who's sick, it's always good to pray for people who've seen sick people get better miraculously. It just helps. It's better, or, as opposed to people say, oh, it ain't going to happen. Just so you know, if you ever get real sick, God loves everybody, but surround yourself with the people who've seen it before if you can. Okay, because it helps. It helps to see it before, because it's easier and easier to believe when you've seen it before. Now, I've seen lots of things I only saw the first time. You know, there's always the first time, but in general, if you're the one sick, surround yourself that way. So we took Susie and Donna, we went over there and we stayed for a couple hours and got a chance to be with them. And you know, you all know Jerry, and Jerry loved him so well. I don't think he was ever as happy in his life than he was. And that's really the saddest thing to me, is not Rob going to be with Jesus. It's knowing that Jerry and him were so happy, and she has obviously considerable time, we would expect, before she goes to be with Jesus. And that's what's hardest. It's hardest to be the one that goes, to be the one that doesn't go first in a marriage and a love like they had. So in any case, his daughter's fantastic, but I want you to look at Hebrews chapter 11. Turn with me, Hebrews chapter 11. I want to focus on three verses. I didn't get to the third one at 8 o'clock, which I know you don't believe, but I really didn't. I just did the first, the sixth, and the tenth instead of the first, the sixth, and the 13th. But there's a progression in Hebrews chapter 11 about faith. And I want to talk about this because as we get to the progression and the third expression of this, this is what Rob and I were talking about, is really the end of, you know, verse 10 and verse 13. But I want to show you this. And I want you to know that there's three kind of theological points that the writer of the book of Hebrews is making throughout the book that's starting to come into fullness by the time we get to chapter 11. And the first thing is that God is the creator. And because he is the creator, you'll see this when we get to verse 2, verse 3, you'll see this, but he's the creator. And because he's the creator, he is also the judge. He is the one who will set everything right. Meaning, when he created this universe, he made it to be glorious and the reflection of himself. And he is not happy that this universe is not on the track that he wanted it. And he promises that a day is coming in the future when everything will be set right when Jesus returns. Everything that's wrong will be destroyed. And there'll be a new heaven and a new earth. And one of the fundamental things that we must understand is that our Creator, who loves us and created us out of the abundance and joy of the economic relationship of the Trinity, this wonderful relationship within the Trinity, is that love poured forth with the incredible, glorious idea to create a universe and universes. 600 million, they say that they know of. And that was an expression, the beauty, the diversity, all things of creation, all the different things with all of our different kind of people and mountains and trees. And all that was an expression of the abundance of the love within the Trinity. And that creator, we can count on him to get everything right and to sort everything out in the end. The second thing that the writer of the book of Hebrews, and you have to know this so we can track quicker when we get there. The second thing is, he is a God of resurrection, and the people of faith. And the thing that the writer of the book of Hebrews wants us to know is that the God of resurrection is a God who loves the material world so much that he is not content for even our physical bodies to remain the way they are now, but is ready for a day in which he will reconstitute us. We are embodied on the day of our death. 2 Corinthians 5:8 says, absent from the body, at home with the Lord. Meaning, if we are alive before Jesus, if we die before Jesus comes back, we will be disembodied for a period of time. We will be absent from the body. We might be cremated or we might be buried. Whatever happens to us, in that, we'll be separate for a period. We are embodied. We will be disembodied only to be re-embodied. Because when Jesus returns, we will have a new body. It will really be us. We'll be recognizable. I mean, lots of people write, you know, will we be taller because of our, you know, the glory of that? Will we, you know, I hope that I'll be thin and muscular. Not that I'm not now. I mean, who knows exactly what it would look like to have none of the influence in our DNA and our bodies, our emotions, all these different things, of anything to do with sin for the last generations from the beginning of the creation? Who knows? Maybe we'll all be giants at 18 foot tall. I don't know. Some people say, well, I'll be like we were at 21. I might pick 30, but whatever the point, I don't know how it's going to be. But I do know this, we're going to see Jesus as he is in his glorified body, and we will be like him. So the writer of the book of Hebrews wants us to know God's a God of creation, and he will put everything right. And number two, he is a God of resurrection. He loves this physical world so much. One day it will live again properly as a new heaven and earth, and we will live and experience even the physicality of our being completely in a glorified fashion. And then the third thing he wants us to know is he is a God of redemption. He has made a covenant promise in Jesus that all those who know Jesus, Savior and Lord, will know him in this life and the life to come. All right, that's the background you kind of have to have if you have been focusing on Hebrews, so that now I can refer back to those three things and we can now look at this and move a little quicker so that you can get out of here in an hour and a half instead of 4 hours. That's the hope. All right, here we go. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Now, I have to jump ahead here, but in this way. Hope is the belief that God's story and that the God of creation will set everything right. Some of us, the sad thing is, our faith is only being expressed in the tiniest amount of hope. We've lived enough to know and that we accepted Christ as Savior, but we've not got very far along the path. And really, we're able to live enough at peace knowing if we die, everything will be okay. That's hope. If we die, we'll be with you. But we haven't experienced and diligently sought God in such a way that we can enjoy day by day. We have the hope to believe in the future, but not in tomorrow. With our marriages and our finances and our health and our children and our grandkids and the politics. So we have the faith that's expressed in salvation and a hope for the future, and we can quiet our fears and our anxieties about the day of our death, most of us. But maybe we haven't really progressed that much in the other ways. And the writer of the book of Hebrews says, faith is the substance, meaning if you know the story and you know that God will set everything right, then you can look into the future and the promise of what God will ultimately complete perfectly, and you can bring that in by faith and trust in Jesus, and you can transform the day of this day and tomorrow. Faith is believing in Jesus for right now, so that the life right here, through the forgiveness of sins, through the power of the Holy Spirit, through healing, through exorcism, through prayer, through seeking him for the things we need in our finances, for the things we need for our cities, our nation, that we can pray and eternity can begin to transform right here and now. Meaning, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as is in heaven. That's hope and faith. To know and to believe that God will set it right then, and to believe in that and to pray then into now. People who really know God well and profoundly, and we've grown in our faith, we begin to be able to live by faith. Faith is saying, I can be anchored in now, not just hoping for the future. We hope for the future, and we can bring that into now. And then the writer of the book of Hebrews is going to say, and the people who really have faith, they've learned to hope, to live in the now, and to long for the life to come. Here we go. So, sorry, there's nothing you can do with this voice. It's something, I'll be honest with you, it sounds funny, but it's something spiritual. I don't talk like this until Thursday night or Sunday morning. And it's something we've got to pray off the church. We have lots of intercessors, but it's something crazy because it doesn't happen any other time. I can yell at my kids for an hour and not sound like that. Not that I would ever have to. That's a metaphor. Now, faith is a substance. Imagine, it's like in Star Trek. Hey, I'm not a Star Trek fan, but you know they did the little beam me up, Scotty. You could dematerialize and materialize. It's like saying faith allows to bring things from heaven, the prerogatives, the privileges of God, into now. Even to the point where physical bodies that can't heal can heal. Even to when there's spiritual beings that can't be seen that are blocking us can be removed. Even when it means that anxiety and emotional harm can be fixed. Politics, families, it's like bringing into substance. Now, we have physicists in our church. We have one that sits where Dion sits every Sunday at 8. And I can't say, a lot of you are a lot smarter than me, but in some sense, you know, you have this E equals MC squared, this idea that matter is connected with the speed of light and energy, that the world was created from something which is not visible and wasn't present. And yet it can become matter. It can become something that can be the substance. You can actually see a heart change. You can see a shoulder change. You can see a marriage change. You can see people's emotions and their depression and their anxiety. You can see it come into here and into now and us not be the same. This is what the writer of the book of Hebrews is telling us. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. The day when it'll all be perfectly set right, we can begin by faith to bring it in and start to transform the here and now. It is the evidence of things not seen, for by it the elders, the old folks, the ones that went before, for it by the elders obtained a good testimony. Who called it good? God did. Some of them, nobody cheered. Some of them we're going to find out in chapter 11. We're not going all there today. Some of them were cut in pieces as martyrs. But the Bible says they had a good testimony, even when the whole world said that they weren't anything. They were nothing, even when they were murdered or whatever. The Bible says, but they had a good testimony. Their witness was approved of by God, and that is the vote that will count. And it's the only vote that really counts. I mean, it's how needed it is to agree with God. But whether people agree with God or not, there's only one vote that counts, and it's his. And when he sees the faith of his people, he says, absolutely thrilling. And he pours out his righteousness, his salvation, and then all these other things as we learn to begin to access them by faith. By faith we understand. Now he's getting back to the creator thing. By faith we understand, verse 3, that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which are visible. He spoke into visible things that we can touch and see. He spoke them out of what is invisible. The scholars tell you this. Either there was an invisible reality that he made visible, or he means that he created out of nothing. But in any way, it wasn't substance before he called it into material existence. He's the creator. And he has every intention of getting things right in the end. By faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which are visible. Then he tells about two remarkable people who were good examples. He tells us about Abel, who believed in God, and it caused him to worship differently. And because of that, he was approved. And then we hear about Enoch, who walked with God, meaning it pleased God. And it says that God that he knew God, and then he was not. That God came and got him and took him away. So we have a person who was murdered as an apparent loser, who God says, no, he was approved. And then we have a guy who lived, and he lived so profoundly that God took him up because he was to be a prophetic sign that there's more to this life and that there is not an end, even when the vast majority of people experience physical death. Two people besides Jesus never died in the flesh that we know of. Right? If you went to Sunday school, you know Enoch and Elijah. Very good. Some Sunday school people over here. This is good. I heard it over here. So a few people are paying attention when they were kids. All right, here we go. Great. All right. By faith, Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. By the way, there's this hope here that all these people are approved. In every instant, there were those who were not approved. That's why we need to be paying attention. Because some folks were approved and some weren't. Abel offered in faith, and it aggravated his brother that even though he could have fixed it and been approved too, he chose to murder out of the wickedness of his heart. It was a choice he made that he didn't have to make. Through which Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, through which he obtained witness that he was righteous. I mean, his brother said, "You're the loser," and killed him. But the God who judged said he's righteous because he did it in faith. Test of God, testifying of his gifts, and through it, he being dead still speaks because he's a God of resurrection. We said that in the beginning, right? He's a God of creation, and he loves creation so much he'll get it right. He's a God of resurrection. And Abel is still speaking. Abel is not silent. Abel is with God in the light to come. He's still speaking because what happened to him isn't the end of the story any more than when we die at 15 or 50 or 80 or 90, whatever age it is. Verse 5, by faith Enoch was taken away so he did not see death. It says, and he was found not. He walked with God and was found not. That's a Genesis chapter 5, verse 24. Can you imagine? That? He walked with God. He's so intimate. He walked with God and then he wasn't found because God took him as a prophetic sign that the normal order of things is not the real order. I mean, the normal things of which we see is not the real order, that there's life to come. He was a testament and anticipation of resurrection life. By faith, Enoch, verse 5, was taken away so he did not see death and was not found because God had taken him. For before he was taken, he had this testimony. This is what God said about him, that he pleased God. Boy, what could be more wonderful than to say, and God said, he pleased me. What was it? Was he just such a better person? The whole point of all this, he pleased God because he believed in God. There's nobody who's good enough. Enoch was a very special, holy guy. But that wouldn't be enough except for he believed in God. That's what pleased him. That's why it was accredited to him as righteousness. He longed for more. He knew he did not have what it takes. And he looked to God and God said, yes, you please me because you look to find your righteousness in me. Verse 6, now we hear the second, first one. We talk about the hope in the future being brought in the present makes things real. The physical order changes by people who have hope and then begin to operate in faith. Knees heal, shoulders heal, cancers leave, spines turn, all kinds of things can happen. Everything's possible to those who believe. It's rooted in hope, knowing that this is God's going to get it right, and then beginning to ask on earth as in heaven, bring it in here. Then verse 6, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. Enoch pleased him. He walked with God and was not. And it was said he pleased him. Well, it's because of faith. And without faith, it's impossible to please God. You can't be good enough. You may do better than everybody else. But if you don't have faith in God, who has chiefly revealed himself in Jesus Christ, his perfect life and sacrificial death, without faith there, you cannot please God, faith in him. It's impossible. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. For he who comes to God must believe he is. He's the God of creation. He's the God of judgment. He's the God of resurrection. He's the God of life. He's the God of redemption. He must believe he is and that he is a rewarder. He lavishes good things upon those who diligently seek him. Now here's the rub for us. It's possible to have enough faith to get to heaven and miss all the fun of diligently seeking God so that we get changed in the process and our faith grows so that we can experience all the things that God has for us in Christ. Every Sunday we pray about the innumerable benefits, meaning when Jesus died on the cross, of course, he saved our sins and he forgives our sins as we believe in him. But Jesus said, I came to preach the gospel to the poor in spirit, but what else did I do? I came to heal the brokenhearted. There's emotional healing. Came to sight the blind, physical healing. Set free those cast in darkness and in bondage to free them from the powers of darkness, to release them in the year of Jubilee, the year of God's favor, to restore in the inheritance that God has apportioned for individual marriages and families and generations. That is part of what Jesus said he came to do. And so much of the church we talk about, in the, at least the biblical church, we talk about salvation, but we've missed that there's so much more that God wants to do as a testament of what he will do finally and completely in the life to come. We're supposed to long and to bring heaven onto earth so people know that one day the job will be done when Jesus returns. And that's the rub. The rub is that things aren't done and won't be done completely until Jesus returns. On the other hand, God is looking for people of faith who trust in Jesus, who bring heaven into the earth by faith and change the earth in the meantime. This is what Rob and I are talking about. See, because the question is, how do you know when you've done your part? Rob's concern was, God's put this thing on my heart and I don't feel like I got it done. And how do we know when? When is enough enough? When have we brought enough of heaven into earth and loving and caring and serving God and believing? How do we know when that's enough and it's time to go on and to inherit fully in the life to come? What's the answer to that? When God takes you home, at least we know that's for sure it. On Monday, he was not responsive in words. He did come out of it, and he was in stage, as you say, but he did come out when his brothers got there. And he said, you know, hi, Richard, hi, Horace. I mean, he was able to, but when I was there, and Susan was there Monday, all he could do is squeeze our hand. He would kind of groan. We were talking about the Lord and his grace, and he would respond. He was responsive. We knew he was paying attention, but he was not talking to me in sentences. But I will tell you, he was very much in stage. I've done a lot of work with hospice. I've been with a lot of people when they died. But I want you to know, when we went there on that Monday, I had every expectation he'd raise up. When I got the text that he died on Tuesday, Susan and I were heading there. Actually, I think I was heading there. Susie couldn't go on Tuesday, I think. But in any case, I got the text, and I can't tell you how satisfied I was. I was satisfied that God said, okay, he had finished the part he's supposed to do. And the reason is because on Monday, God's presence and his glory, it was there so powerfully, I fully expected, knowing who God is, that God would raise him up. Not because I'm ignorant. I know we can't do anything. I don't think I have enough faith. I just know that the Holy Spirit moves in the nature of who God is. And we were there on Monday. You know, to believe and to not doubt takes a gift from God. There's always a part of me that knows that he may not heal. This, that humanly speaking, I know that I can't make anything happen. I don't think I'm Wonder Boy. But there is a gift when the Spirit comes where you can believe and not doubt, not because of us, but because God gives it to us. On Monday, the room was filled like that. But when I heard he died, I thought, at some level, Rob realized, had a lot of conversation about this, not just with me, with BE and others, that his part of bringing heaven into earth and the task of serving God and glorifying God, that his chapter was done. And at least in my heart, I'm fully convinced that he made the decision, okay, I haven't left it undone, I'm able to go. He battled. He lived much longer, I don't even realize, than what he was supposed to with pancreatic cancer. And his concern was, I haven't got done what God told me to do. About a month ago or so, he began to believe different people, that no, maybe he had looked at it wrong, and maybe, in fact, he had finished what he was. And it seemed to me, at some level, we saw things accelerate. The more at peace he was with his life, the more death seemed to accelerate in him. I can't speak for God. This is what I think. But I know the faith in God's presence and glory was there on Monday. And I know that I had such a peace and a satisfaction that, okay, sort of it is well with my soul in a way that you can't be unless God's there. And the last thing he and I were talking about was verse 10 and verse 13, which we're going to get to in just a second, of talking about when in some level we can never fully inherit what God has promised because it can't come into the life to come. This is what he and I were talking about. We were praying for faith, he'd come back, finishing up. But on the other hand, we said, you know, the things we really long for and hope God will do in our lives really can't be done fully and completed in this life. Only when Jesus returns and everything's made straight will all those things be completed. So look with me in the text as we continue. Wait a minute. The point for us is We are required to diligently seek God, to be in His Word, to pray, to do things, and in which processes the Holy Spirit moves within us, and we're able to believe in a way we didn't believe. Part of the reason that we read the Scriptures, we worship, we take the sacrament, we serve, it is we do these indirect processes, and as we do them, the Holy Spirit blesses us with more and more of Jesus and more of the Holy Spirit. Okay, we spend time with God in the things of God, and then God pours out lavishly good things upon people who make it their business to focus and respond and to make their life about Jesus. God pours out good things on those people. Not necessarily a good life, meaning an easy life, but he reveals faith and intimacy and these things to the people who diligently seek. He's a rewarder. He is lavish. I would wonder if there's weakness that we've experienced in the past is we don't really understand how much God wants to lavish good things upon us if we would make it our business to seek him, to knock, to seek, and to ask more intently than ever before. We live in a day in which probably half our congregation only comes to weekly worship every 3 or 4 weeks. Listen, I'm not trying to give you a hard time, but I will tell you something. That was unheard of, where people of God for all of history would never dream of not ordering their lives upon the weekly public worship of God. That's so radically different. We live in a different age, but I'm going to tell you something. That's not right. Our lives must be ordered. Now, this is not the only thing by any means. But part of what it means to be a believer is that people understood themselves to be excommunicated. They were not in church when they physically could get to church. That's how the church looked at it. There's no thing that could keep us from the worship of the Lord Jesus Christ. When they came together, when the churches experienced God in the proper ways, the Holy Spirit would be moving. People, and I think this church is growing in our worship, in our praise, but you know how many times people could be sit there and there's responses? The church and our services are set up so that we can enter in. It takes work. That's why it's called the work of the people, liturgy. It takes work to focus, to respond in the prayers, to sing, whether you're a good singer or not a good singer. Meaning, everybody's been doing it for 2,000 years, and we live in a generation that even in conservative, Bible-believing churches, it's not really a big deal to us. Sure, there's grace, but when are we really disrespecting God? That's the question. I'm never going to call you up and give you a hard time, but I am going to tell you, I don't believe it's right. I don't believe it's right. We are required to order our lives as the family of God on the worship, the sacraments, and then a whole lot more. In terms of our daily reading, surrender to the Holy Spirit, serving. I mean, there's all kind of that. That's just the beginning. But something that would have been considered essential is something which is very casual. I guarantee it, these things are not supposed to be. Part of what he says in Hebrews chapter 12 is devoting ourselves to the meeting together. This is supposed to be something. And you know what? To do this right, you have to prepare the day before to get here. Did you know that? I rarely do anything on a Saturday night. I will certain anniversary, but I'll try to go to someone's party or whatever because I don't want to be disrespectful to friends and people. But I don't even go out to dinner. Now think about this. You know how I eat. I don't even go out to dinner on a Saturday night. I cannot be where I've got to be on a Sunday morning without thinking, praying, being in God's word. I got to make a shift. I'm going to tell you something. Our services will change when the people of God get prepared on Saturday to be here on Sunday. If you wait to confess your sins in a Eucharist, and then you're just saying the words. If we're just getting familiar with the text on a Sunday, we are not letting God touch us and do what he wants to do in public worship. That's part of why we're casual, because we're not connecting as deeply as God wants to connect. But there is a part where we must do some things to prepare so that we can. Enough, there you go. By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things yet not seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his household, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. You know, in the New Testament, that Noah's ark is the symbol of what the church is. Imagine being told by God about a flood when you'd never seen a flood. And being told on a singular day, as far as we can tell, do this and to prepare, and someone stuck at it for 100 years when everybody thought he was an absolute idiot until it started to rain. Not when it started to rain, when it rained and rained. Do you see he is a picture for us? Most of us weren't going to live 100 years, but the point of this and the reason it's so important is that we're supposed to live with the kind of focus on living and doing what God has revealed for us to do. It won't be built in art, but nonetheless, knowing that we will be condemning in our holy living people who will hate us like Cain hated Abel, not because we're knuckleheads or being or holding a big Bible, but because we're walking with Jesus, the Spirit in them will turn a lot of them off. And yet other ones will get saved and join us, so to speak, in the ark. In some ways, the way this thing is going with Hebrews, just so you know, and I'm not preaching the whole chapter, but in many ways, Noah is the example, even bigger in some ways, of anyone else in this chapter. Because of what the scripture says and about this ark, he becomes in some ways the framework for everything here. In any case, there's more pictures. He says, by faith Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out of a place which he would receive as inheritance. And he went out not knowing where he's going. Do you see that's the key? He trusted God not knowing where he's going. God expects us to live for him and to make him the ultimate focus and to be dedicated with everything in our lives to focus on him, even though we don't know all the things that are coming. I mean, I can't tell you how many times I said, well, Lord, I would do it if I, you know, well, tell me, explain. And you know what I've learned after a number of years is that if I had known where God was taking me, I wouldn't have done it. I mean, it all turned out. I'm so grateful how life has turned out. But if I had known, because back when I was younger, I did not think the same way about things as I do now. And with the mindset that I had back then, I would have said, no, I'm so grateful God didn't tell me. Because with the things that he told me, he also changed me so that I realized the goodness of where he was taking me instead of that it was something bad. Where if I was had my whole life in front of me, if you had told me that I would ever know a charismatic person or a person who believed, I would have said, absolutely not, I'm not going. And in fact, for at least 10 years, as God was trying to help me in some very deep depression in my 20s, he sent me charismatic people, and I told them, I didn't say go to hell, but I basically said, I smiled and said, basically, thank you, and I had nothing to do with them. And God had sent them for relief that I needed, and even more, maybe in some way, Susie needed, because she was living with me. I lost a decade. He went out not knowing where he was going. But he had a glimpse of God, and that was enough. By faith, he dwelt in the land of promise as in a foreign country. God said it was his, but he lived as an alien and a stranger. That had to be hard to say, I know God said I'm supposed to be the one. Instead, I'm the one always kind of moving out of the way. The Bible says he lived in tents, but he was looking for a city. Look here. Dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise, but they lived as outsiders when it was theirs to own. And then here's the key, for he waited for the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. So in this process of faith, of hoping into the future, and then obeying and transforming the present, Abraham still realized that what God had promised was too good to receive completely and fully in this life. So he did not die brokenhearted. Instead, he began to long for the day in which the life to come would give him in fullness everything which God has promised. So the progression of faith is to know God and to believe him and to believe about the life to come. And then we learn to grow and receive by faith, by following God. Our faith grows and we learn to take the future into now by faith, to transform our daily living and experience the lavish goodness of God who is looking for you, who will seek him, and he pours out more and more good things. He's looking for people. But then there's always a peace which we will not have until the light to come. And so he says, even for the ones who did the most, I mean, here Abraham, I mean, look at his life, or Moses, but even the ones who experience the most, there's always more to the promise that they recognize. I won't get it all until the life to come. Look at verse 13. I'm jumping ahead of Sarah and Abraham, but these all died in faith, not having received the promises. I mean, they received part of the promises, but meeting, not receiving them all. Not having received the promises, not as losers, but having seen them afar. You see, they in hope, they begin to bring, and their lives change, and so they begin to see so much they did inherit that they begin to realize and long for what they couldn't, and they could see it in the distance, and they were content. They're satisfied. But having seen them afar off, we're assured of them. Embraced them. And confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Now listen, Rob wasn't a perfect guy. Okay? I really didn't. He did confess his sins, by the way. Some of you don't know. You could be sitting with Rob, and he'd say, I just got to confess my sins. And he'd start confessing, and it would make you want to cry because his conscience was so tender. But he wasn't a perfect guy. I got to see him when he was about as perfect as you could probably be. I mean, I found nothing but delight in the guy. I don't want to get the wrong idea. The point about Rob is not that he was so different than us. It's that he was just like us, and he made it his business to focus on God, and that is what he longed for day and night. That's what's so neat about him. That's what's so awesome. I honestly believe that a shift happened where he began to realize and to long from afar some of the things he thought he would inherit here. And I think that's why there was so much peace and glory when we were with him. And I honestly think that's why he let go and received himself into Jesus. Let Jesus take him and receive him into his hands. It was one of the most profound. I've been in the first 2 years I was here in Gainesville, 1996 and 7, I was with 25 people when they died. I had never been at a funeral. When I was a kid in the 70s, 80s, they thought you should protect kids from funerals. So it's quite a shock if you've never been to one. But anyway, I was holding people's hands when they died, and I've seen all kind of things. I've never seen the kind of peace. I mean, I've saw many wonderful deaths where you knew God was there. But I'll tell you something, I never felt how I did, as sad as I am, for myself, for Jeree, for the rest of us, his daughters. But I'll tell you something, I felt like the assured of the things that he was looking for. I felt like I could taste it for him. And boy, was it beautiful. It was glorious, even as it's sad. But I think for us, it's to recognize that there is, in the example of a guy like Rob and many others, even really a lot of good examples in this room, there is a time to kind of, what does the emerald say, take it up a notch, to get a bit more focused in our worship, in our commitments to God, in our focus of God, to look at the examples of the Noahs and the other, and to say, you know what, here's some people that made it their business to make the Lord the main thing. And they weren't freaks. They were more loving, more neat than everybody else. They were only freaks to the people that end up hating God. Now this week on Wednesday, I went and I brought my phone because I want to read you a text. On Wednesday, I went to a hospital for people here, members of our church, and the procedure was to check to see if the valve of the heart that was leaking after another procedure, if in fact it was gonna good enough to hold, and everything else. And so we went, we prayed, and his wife's here this morning, and so we did all that. And honestly, I felt really good, and I was teasing about wanting to play golf with him before he got back to full health, and then bet money on it. That's what I was hoping to do. And I left feeling very much at peace. And yet the word that came in that day was, his heart is not good. The valve is too weak. His heart is not good enough, and he will die shortly. That's what. And these are mature Christian people. And in one sense, it was amazing in the text. There was a contentment and a knowledge of Jesus that they were absolutely stable in that. And that was amazing. That's not a little thing. That's not a baby Christian that responds the way they did when they heard It's over. I mean, this day's going to work out, but it's over. And then this is the text I got Thursday. Patsy, would you come? It's your text. We might as well let you read it. Your text on my phone, but hold it close just because it won't pick it up otherwise.
Something is going on, unbelievable. The heart doc wanted to try an IV drip to see if it would improve a failing heart. The Lord is doing something. Jack is not pumping to breathe. Has energy, color in his face, unreal. It is the Lord. He is in charge. He has intervened and listened and answered prayer. And I want to tell you, when my husband started pumping to breathe,
you got to hold it up, sorry.
Pumping to breathe, pale color, we both knew he was dying. And something happened different than what you would expect. You know, when you pray for healing, which is fine. But when Father Ron came and prayed, I knew something was going to happen. But I wasn't sure what it was, but it was going to happen. And that's faith. Mm. And the reason I had that faith, a couple of reasons. Number one, he gave it to me, and he'll give it to you.
Thank you, Lord.
Number two, I've done biblical counseling for years, and I've seen God heal marriages, physical healings. I saw it all. So it's true. Surround yourself with people that know, and it'll rub off on you because this God wants faith. And I told Jack, it's not over, Jack. Let's wait and see. So when I went back up to the hospital the next morning, I almost lost it. Here's my husband sitting there with a rush of pink color to his face. He's not pumping. He's not fatigued. He got up, walked around, sat in the chair. I had to sit down and get myself together. But what I really wanted to do then was to tell other people about it that didn't believe in God, because they were in and out of the room. And I did it in a way where no one was offended, but they were looking and thinking. So I believe seeds were planted for these medical people to take another look at this situation.
Thank you, Patsy.
You can clap for that.
Let's go back to just the verse 1 as I close in prayer. Now faith is the substance. Bring into the material world that we see and feel and touch. It is the substance of things hoped for. It takes a belief in Jesus' story and God's story. He is the creator. And he's the judge. It takes the hope and the faith in that story to begin to take that story into our own stories. And that happens by faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. It is the evidence when it begins to transform our lives. It is the evidence of things not seen. It is the movement of the invisible into the visible. Rob loved to pray all the love in the world. His daughter mentioned, I forgot, but on Monday, I prayed that because that's what Rob loved to pray. As he would lay hands on people, many of you, he probably did, you probably heard him say it. And Jesus, give him all the love in the world. And so many times, we saw what is invisible, all the love in the world in Christ, manifest, changing, healing, transforming things as he prayed and as he loved and lived. We want to be like that. We want to be like Noah and Abraham and Sarah and all the rest of them. But we must involve ourselves in the indirect processes like reading God's prayers together, worshiping, singing, giving ourselves with a focus. The way that God pours out more and more faith is that we make it our business to focus upon him. And the more we focus upon him, the more he pours out the capacity to believe and to be changed. We find ourselves believing more in the story. We find it easier then to take the truth of the story into our own lives by faith. And then we begin to see there's so much for us, we then begin to long for the day in which we could do almost anything. So much so that we wonder. And then we realize, oh, there's still some part that will be left, because we'll always be left longing for everything. The only place it will be set completely right is when Jesus returns. Lord Jesus, this morning we come and we say, Lord, we want to diligently seek you. Lord, we want to be people who believe. And Lord, the truth is that all of us are different places on this thing. But Lord, I pray that you would help us to diligently seek you, to realize we have a part to play. Lord, that as we diligently seek you, you will lavish upon us all kinds of good things, including the capacity to grow in our faith. Lord, we want to be people that we see the substance of what we hope for. Lord, to know that everything's possible to those who believe in you. And Lord, we have so many things that we can practice on, marriages and personality defects and heartache and physical things and things for our nation, the world, and our city, and our neighbors. And Lord, there's just so many things. Lord, we pray that you would shift in this place together, that as the people of God, we would not just seek, but we'd seek together. Something happens when a family of God in a particular church here or there begins to long and to seek you together. We're able to help each other. And all of a sudden, it does rub off, and it gets easier and easier. Particularly as we see more and more of your miracles and your good things that you do. Lord, help us, strengthen us. Help us understand our part of presenting ourselves in diligence. And Lord, in you then, knowing that you'll lavish upon us everything we need to grow. We don't have to manufacture anything. We're not here to pretend. But as we make it our business to make you number one in our lives, you'll pour out everything we need. It's already been provided, but it begins to flow into this earth, and we're different and changed by it, and the people around us are too. So would you bless us? Would you help us? Would you strengthen us? Lord, we give you the little that we are, and we say, please purify, do whatever it takes to get us there. We ask it in the most wonderful, the most precious name, the name of Jesus, and in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost, amen. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven.